how better to spend your Saturday afternoon than get your T-shirt on, get with a few thousand of your good friends, and go to the stock car races. I'm Dave Despain, welcoming you to exclusive World Sports live coverage of a great stock car race. We've got the Grand National Racers of NASCAR coming to the Commonwealth of Virginia, Richmond International Raceway, for a battle for the championship. This guy who swears his name is James Bond thinks that Dale Earnhardt's going to win this race today. Over here, these folks from Virginia are pulling for the Commonwealth favorite son. They said watch number 42, Elton Sawyer. I think this is the best seat in the house right here with the fans. The only guy who would argue with that is way up top of this place, and he'll be calling the action today. Let's go topside for Ken Squire.
Au contraire, Dave. We have the best seat in the house right up here high above that start-finish line. For 200 laps, 150 miles of competition on this three-quarter mile highway to havoc or glory. 36 drivers have qualified for the $100,000 contest. And our expert and ardent fan, Johnny Hayes, how do you see it?
Well, Ken, I think we have the perfect situation. We have all our Winston Cup heroes, high finance teams. We have Darrell Waltrip, Dale Earnhardt, Mark Martin, Harry Gant, going against a field of the top short track drivers in America. But there's something playing in their favor today. This is really a modified short track. So these big heroes might have a problem. So why don't y'all sit back and put on your seat belts, because my Grand National boys like to take the heroes for a ride today.
Helping us to bring you the action today, one of the great talents of American stock car racing, Neil Bonnet. Neil, this is a new track as of a year ago. Tell us about this three-quarter mile D-shape, which they're going to be competing on.
Ken, the first thing you have to take in consideration is this used to be a half-mile racetrack. They stepped it up to a little over three-quarters of a mile. They had to take the existing real estate, and that dictated the shape of the racetrack. It's a little bit unique in the design. Down the front straightaway, big wide straightaway, cars two and three abreast, but when you enter that first turn, they got a single file. The guy on the outside is going to be tiptoeing around. The worst place, the hardest place on the racetrack, exiting at turn two. We've had cars in the wall all week in practice. You're probably going to see some of that today. Back straightaway, big wide, lures you three abreast down through there, two or three abreast a lot of times. Same thing, narrow entry into three, real wide exit off four, the easiest part of the racetrack. The D-shape lets you really swing off the corner. You're going to see guys make the passes off four and then bunch up going in one again. It's going to be some sparks flying. These Winston Cup guys really on these other guys' turf, and they want to get after them.
And it will be at an average speed of 118 miles per hour that they cover this turf this afternoon. So stand by for World Sports live flag-to-flag coverage of the Commonwealth 200 from Richmond. We're live at the Richmond International Raceway awaiting the start of the 200 lapper this afternoon, and let's meet the man on the pole with veteran racecaster Johnny Harbin.
Hello, this is Charlie Harbin. Ken, we're glad to be here, believe me. And Tommy Ellis has started on the pole more often than anybody in the history of Busch Grand National Series, but this is his first pole start of this season. You told me yesterday you might just race against the people who are close to you in the points, Tommy Houston and Rob Moroso and so forth.
Well, basically what I meant was that's the main thing we've got. That's the main objective, is to race the people that we're racing against. If I'm running good enough to win, naturally I'm going to run hard all day. But if somebody gets putting pressure on me on my car's not performing well enough to win, then the second thought of mine is to race the guys that I'm racing against in the points. This is what I've got to do. If I can finish all the races and stay ahead of these guys, then I can win a championship. But you've got to finish all the races, and you've got to be able to beat them, you know, to get the points, maintain the points that you've got, and you got to beat them to gain points. So basically I've got to be concerned with these guys, and these are the guys that I've got to race. But we're here to win. We're going to try to win, and if everything goes right, we can put this Goo Goo Cluster Buick in victory circle today.
Okay, Tommy, thanks very much. Michael Waltrip will be starting on the outside of the front row. Mike Joy is with him.
Thank you, Charlie. While Grand National regulars have the inside of the front two rows, it's Winston Cuppers on the outside. And Mike Waltrip, who won in this series at Indianapolis Raceway Park, has the outside pole. He's getting strapped in. He's got his weekly racing paper in here, and he looks a little warm already. That's about to change.
Boy, it's hot. I tell you, it's been this way two Saturdays in a row. It was real hot down in Darlington, but we think our little post-serials Pontiac is going to run real well today, and we're looking forward to the race.
Great run to get the outside pole, and I know this is fun racing for you guys.
Yeah, it is a lot of fun, you know. And the funny deal about our situation, we ran about five laps before qualifying and lost an engine, ran five laps since then and hadn't run any more. So we don't know what we're to expect. Hi, Mom.
Okay. Doing good. We'll find out in a second. That's Mike Waltrip, who has a brother lined up right behind Darrell Waltrip. who'll be carrying our in-car camera today, getting checked out. And I know it's been a while since you had a camera in the car.
Yeah, let's see. I've never had one in this car. I had one in the car at, I forget.
Well, what kind of race are we going to see today? I know that's the topic that's uppermost on your mind.
Well, it's hot, you know. It's pretty hot out here today, and it's humid. It's a little unusual for us because we're running radial tires on the Winston Cup cars. Today on these cars, we're running the bias tires. The car has a totally different feeling. We're a little concerned about setup. We're not sure if we got the car set up properly or not for the track conditions. It was good this morning. Things have changed a lot before now, though.
Okay, we're about to find out. Good luck, Darrell. And let's go back along the starting grid to Charlie Harville once more.
Rob Moroso is in contention for the championship in the Busch Grand National Series, too. Tommy Ellis says he has to worry about you and Tommy Houston, Jack Ingram, and L.D. Ottinger. How will you run this event?
Well, I'm going to start out trying to win it, and if something happens, I think we can win it. But if something really happens to the car or something, then it's just a race against the guys that are in the points and see if we can finish ahead of them.
That's Rob Moroso, all set to race today. Dave Despain's up in the stands with the crowd. Dave, what do you see there?
Well, I tell you what, we got a three-quarter mile battleground that's about to turn into a war zone. Got all those experts up on top, all those experts down on pit road. Young heroes ready to take on the big stars. Let's ask the real experts. Who's going to win this thing today? It's unanimous. It's going to be a great race. We'll be right back with the action.
We're back with you at the Richmond International Raceway, awaiting the start of the Commonwealth 200. Right now, let's take a look at the starting order for this afternoon's event. On the pole, the 84 and 85 winner from Richmond, Tommy Ellis. Alongside is Michael Waltrip, winner of one race this year in Grand National Competition. Number 25 will start inside of row two. Three-time winner this year, Robbie Moroso from Connecticut. And it will be Darrell Waltrip at number 17 alongside, carrying our in-car camera. In row three is Davey Allison, Ford. And on the outside, Rick Wilson at number 75 out of Florida. Inside of row four is Chuck Bound from Portland, Oregon. Had a great qualifying run, and the Ironman five-time champion Jack Ingram is alongside. For row five is number 09. This is Joe Bessie from Massachusetts. Outstanding qualifying effort. And Harry Gant, who won this race 1 year ago, won at Darlington a week ago, is ready to roll in car number seven. Take a look at the rest of the starting field. Mark Martin comes up next. He'll be running in the row six with the 87 winner there. Alongside is Elton Sawyer. Going to row seven now. That's the Buick for Rick Mast out of Virginia. And the 86 winner, Dale Earnhardt's there in that black number three, the Goodwrench car. Going to row eight this afternoon, it's Kenny Wallace, the outstanding rookie from Missouri in a Pontiac. And alongside is Tom Peck. That's that number 96 car. Going to row nine, and there's Resendez from Massachusetts in the number 79 Oldsmobile. And Kelly Moore out of Scarborough, Maine, in that 74 car Chevy. Row 10 is Wayne Patterson. He's from Virginia, the number 14 Pontiac. And the 02 Buick is Kenny Burks of Stewart's Draft, Virginia. Row 11 today, there you have car number 70, and that's Jimmy Hensley's Buick out of Ridgeway, Virginia. And Donnie Ling Jr. from Brick, New Jersey, is the white and blue number 66. For row 12, it's car number 24. That's Joe Thurman, the former national champion, one of the real veterans from Rocky Mount, Virginia. And alongside is the Grand National North champion from a year ago and current point leader, Jamie Obie, in car number 41 from North Ferrisburg, Vermont. Going to row 13, and there you have Tommy Houston at Hickory, North Carolina. Car number six, he's leading in the Grand National points these days, but just by 15 points. And alongside is number two, L.D. Ottinger of Newport, Tennessee. Let's go down and get the start right now.
Gentlemen, start your engines.
Richard Petty, synonymous with Richmond for so many years, commanding these Grand National cars to come to life. Car number 81, Bobby Hillen Jr. there out of Midland, Texas. And beside him will be Robert Presley in car number 59 to round out row 14. Moving to row 15 this afternoon, there you have car number 8, Bobby Hamilton in a Buick out of Nashville, Tennessee, and Jimmy Spencer's Pontiac. Now, Jimmy had three wins earlier this year, then went Winston Cup racing. Row 16 is Dana Patton, car number 86, the white and red machine from Enfield, New Hampshire, and Randy LaJoy out of Connecticut in that number 34, that white Buick. Row 17 today is the Buick number 56. That is Ronald Cooper out of Georgia. And alongside, these are provisional starters here, Cooper and Bill Clark in his Pontiac. That's now listed as number 71. He's from Farmington, Massachusetts. The final row in the field, that's the 19 car, Steve Grissom from Gadsden, Alabama. And he's on baby watch today. He may leave this track at any moment, as he's expecting his first at any minute. And beside him comes the Irish Angel in that Kelly Green, car number zero from Kennebunkport, Maine. Their second most important person up there this summer, Dick McCabe. Field rolling out, and car number 87's having a problem as they get ready to roll out here. Hood is up on number 87 as they try to get Jimmy Spencer. That's the Buddy Baker car, that Pontiac. Jimmy Spencer, Berwick, Pennsylvania, trying to get fired up here. Had three wins early in the season with six in points. Hasn't been running regularly here over the last half of the season. Field rolling away. It's 200 laps. It's live on World Sports Today. Alongside Neil Bonnet, Johnny Hayes. Looks like a good field. Wish you were out there today, Neil.
Well, I'll tell you, it's nice and warm out there. You got some good cars going. It looks like the 87 car, the ignition in these cars are, they're either fully on or they're fully off. And I saw him changing the boxes around, and when they won't crank, there's nothing you can do to them other than go and replace it. Looks like he's going to be out for a while.
And get real frustrated. Tommy Ellis is on the pole for the 25th time in his career.
Well, that breaks Sam Ard's record. Sam Ard, one of the greatest that ever lived, was tied with Tommy Ellis, and now the Goo Goo Man has passed him up.
Going for his 22nd career win here today. Wins in 84 and 85 on this track. Ellis, he's a tough customer, up on the pole in car number 99 as they work the tires in a little and get set to go. Neil Bonnet has the record on this track for the fastest stop. He went from 110 to zero at exactly 3 feet out of turn two back on the old half mile. That had to be one of the hardest licks.
Well, I'll tell you what, Ken, it did a lot of things for me. I used to be 5'8", I'm 5'8 and a half now. That was the quickest I've ever stopped. And, you know, the facilities have been updated so much now. You used to see these cars wreck and then take a half hour to get the guardrail put back together. When you wreck nowadays, you build new race cars.
What's great about that, Ken, he was leading the race and didn't have any problems with the car. You know, no tires went down. He just no-brained it and drove her straight through the wall.
Thank you there, Johnny. You're putting in a good word for me.
I wanted to be proud of you. You know, someone your age.
As I remembered, he broke a tire.
Oh,
had
that
a tire come down.
Well, I knew it was one of those.
Speaking
two.
Of tires, there is a tire rule today as we get set to go. One free tire change for each tire position in a caution. We'll explain more about that as we go along. We're coming down to start live the Commonwealth 200 here on World Sports Today from famed Richmond International Raceway, the heartland of American stock car racing. It is Waltrip on the outside, Michael and Ellis, Tommy on the inside, and Tommy makes the bid early, gets the jump, goes into turn number one as they stack. Davey Allison dives down low, tries to sprint up along the bottom. Five different manufacturer makes in the front five positions as they unfurl the first lap. Ellis really pours it on and jumps out in front. Drivers from 18 different states. Virginia has seven of the field coming down by. Actually, nine different states in the top 10 positions today. That's some different than 2 years ago.
And it's great to watch them go by. They're running three and four right wide in places, and I'm telling you, we have a lot of cars.
Jimmy Spencer is back in the race. He's come out in car 487.
I was looking, Ken. It's going to be interesting to see the first guy that gets the car working on the outside. That inside lane is so tough, it's kind of like walking to thin ice. They're going to have to get somebody working on the outside.
And now it streaks away in the 99. The battle is for second place between Michael Waltrip in the 30 and the 17 is brother Darrell. They're having a good scrap. And here comes Robbie Moroso to bust up through there. Moroso down to the inside, looking for his fourth win of the season. Down to the bottom of the racetrack, picks up another spot. Moroso flies. 20 years old. Great future for this young man.
More so than 20 years old, he was beaten on the back bumper of Walter's car. He doesn't have a whole lot of respect. He's ready to go to the front.
As they race down the back straightaway. Coming around in lap four, Ellis is first, Michael Waltrip second, Moroso third, Darrell Waltrip is in fourth. Back to the line, Chuck Bown holding fifth, Rick Wilson sixth, Davey Allison seventh, Mark Martin is eighth, and back in the pits again is car number 87. Spencer not off to a good start at all, going another lap down. There you see the interval between first and second as the 99 Ellis sprinted at the start and moved out in front. Led this race for a distance a year ago. Meanwhile, here's number one, Martin. Martin trying to make a move as the two Fords run side by side down into the corner. Martin on the bottom. Remember, he and Davey got in a real dogfight. We've got one car running very slowly, bottom of the racetrack, Dana Patton in car number 86, the New Hampshire driver. Picks it back up. He lost it, gains it back, starts over. Here is Michael Walter, winner earlier this year at Indianapolis Raceway Park, closing on Tommy Ellis, defending Grand National Champion. Distance as they come around, working lap number seven, about three car lengths. Back in third is Moroso, running fourth. It's Darrell Walter. In fifth, Chuck Bow. Maintaining sixth is Rick Wilson in the 75 car. Mark Martin and Davey Allison continuing their war. They headed out right to the finish at Bristol. Martin coming home victorious. Struggle for the lead. You want to lead this early if you can, Neil?
I tell you what, I think Tommy's car, if it's comfortable, he said before the show, if it's comfortable, he's going to lead. I don't think he's going to run the car in the ground. They're in a unique situation right now with the points battling. He must feel pretty comfortable to be out there, even though Mike closed up on him.
Car number 86 that had trouble earlier now slams the wall. Dana Patton puts it in the wall. First caution of the day comes in lap number 9. Turn number 2 is where it happened. Dana Patton down in car number 86. Runs on the Grand National North Circuit. Dana Patton from Enfield, New Hampshire, parks his Buick in the concrete, currently second up in the north, ninth year in racing, and looks like it's the end of the day for car number 86. See if we can see what happened here. We are under caution. We'll be back with you shortly from Richmond International Raceway as Tommy Ellis is currently commanding the Commonwealth 200. We're back with you working the 13th lap, just back under green, and back in front goes Tommy Ellis as they scoot down the back straightaway of this 3/4 mile track. It's live on World Sports, the Commonwealth 200. Ellis is in front. 20-year-old Robbie Moroso is in second. Michael Waltrip is in third. Darrell Waltrip is maintaining the fourth position as that cluster of cars goes into turn one. Now further back in the field, there you see the 75 car. This is a great fight. Rick Wilson there, then here comes the 22 moving in. That's Rick Mast in the eighth position closing. He's jumped a couple of men since we came back under green. And Rick Mast seems to be on a roll here. Mark Martin is running in fifth, the number one car. Back in front, Moroso, the youngster from New England, ready to challenge Tommy Ellis, 20-year veteran from Virginia.
Ken, you know, Moroso's driving very aggressive today. He was beating on Darrell Waltrip, comes right back, beats on Michael, gets by him. Now he's going after Tommy Ellis, but you better tie it on if you're going to beat on that boy, because you're allowed to be eating some cement walls. So he better be real careful with Tommy Ellis.
Back straightaway. I hear you seeing number 30, Waltrip, trying to close in on those two leaders. That's number 30, Michael Waltrip, maintaining third spot and trying to move in on the leaders. There you have them, the 99 and the 25, and directly behind them comes Michael Waltrip. Good battle for the lead. This at lap 16 of 200. One caution flag already extended. Dana Patton crashing in turn two, gone back into the pit area, trying to get himself sorted out, and has come back on the track a lap down.
Ken, this is just like a bunch of racers. The best I can recall, about 5 minutes ago, these guys running first and second said they weren't going to run their cars very hard. Worried about the points. It looks to me like they're going at it pretty tough right now.
Number 99 out in front, closing in on Tommy Ellis as he streaks down into turn number 3 is this man, number 25, Robbie Moroso. And here comes Michael Waltrip with it. Front three across the stripe and closing up is Mark Martin in fourth. Waltrip falls to fifth.
Ken, you know, this is Tommy Ellis's hometown, and he has all his family and friends out, so he wants to do the best job he can, and he really has a shot at winning another championship.
Good struggle, and look at Michael Waltrip getting physical here as he works on Moroso in the 25. There's your front four.
See, Mark Martin snuck in the picture now. He has his Ford going well, so now we're at the time that the Winston Cup guys are getting real close to the Grand National guys. Let's see what they do.
Waltrip is there again. Michael in the number 30 looks to the inside on Moroso. Three-way tie for most wins this season. And it features Ellis the leader, Moroso the second man on this field, and Jimmy Spencer have all won three races. Here's Waltrip looking for his second win of the season. Sliding down to the inside. Mark Martin is in fourth. Darrell Waltrip fifth. Wilson in the number 75. Wise seventh on the field. Or rather sixth on the field. And seventh is Rick Mass. Look at this scramble.
Hey, it looks like Robbie's car is getting just a little bit loose up off the corner. It certainly doesn't help with that bumper banging on the back of it that Mikey's giving to him. And he's loosening him up a little bit. He's already got a little bit of problem. And he's going to have his hands full here in lap two. When they're loose like that, they don't get better.
From the viewpoint of Darrell Waltrip, with our super close camera, into the view down the main straightaway, running in fifth spot.
What's great, Darrell's the cagey old veteran, watching these four young guys beat each other's brains out. He's just waiting and watching and in a perfect spot. That's just the way he drives his race car, right, Neil?
Yeah, you can always, that's perfect about being a cagey old veteran. You can lay back there. If you're running lousy, you can say you're being cagey. If you're running, if you're being cagey, you can show it at the end.
Pretty exciting when Waltrip takes you right down there in turn four to that fence. Separates the track from going into the pits. We'll get that again for you and let Neil talk a little bit about that. Exciting. Now watch, here's car number 17 diving down to the bottom of the racetrack, and look how close he rides to that fence.
Yeah, that wall right there, they worked on it last year. They cut a little bit of it away, but still you flirt with that thing with the left front fender on the car. I noticed in practice there's even some tire marks on those little barrels down there, so they're getting awful close to it.
Meanwhile, up in front, Ellis sustains the lead. Moroso stays second. Michael Waltrip third. Mark Martin is in fourth. Darrell Waltrip fifth. And Rick Wilson is in sixth. Number 41, Obie pitting. Jamie Obie out of North Harrisburg, Vermont, comes onto pit row. Ellis continuing to try to sprint away from the field.
And that was the first indication right there. If you look, Mark Martin is moving the car to the outside. He's the first one of the guys that's going to try that outside lane. It's like walking on thin ice, and he's going to tiptoe around out there. If he can get that car on the outside, he can work on it pretty good.
Here come those front four down out of the corner. There you see the 99. And behind them, see the blue number one at the end. That is the Mark Martin car. That's the Ford that scored the first Ford V6 victory in Grand National Competition at Bristol. Looking pretty stout right now. Meanwhile, it's Moroso in the Oldsmobile, number 25, that is maintaining that second spot, keeping the Pontiac of Michael Waltrip in third, Ford running fourth. Great mix of cars, Buick up in front. Front four positions, all different manufacturers.
I tell you, the engine stuff has really been like a development program with these guys. The Buick motors, the few Fords that are involved right now, these guys are really doing some work.
We should point out that they're all V6s in this field. Here you are with Ellis, down to the inside in turn three and four. And they tighten up behind him once again.
These people don't need to be misled about a V6 engine. These guys are running virtually the same lap times as the Winston Cup cars do. They're a little bit lighter, but that little motor really accelerates on these racetracks.
3,200 pounds, including the driver on these size tracks. Weigh the driver with the car. 3,700-pound machines that run on the Winston Cup circuit. And these guys on this size track will run as quick as anything. There's that front four, and watch that blue number one on the tail end. Mark Martin trying to find some running room for the Carolina Ford dealers.
Ken, Michael and Darrell's mother had a stroke recently. She's recovering, going well, has been released from the hospital. But I don't know medically if it's smart for you, Mrs. Walter, to be sitting home watching this on TV, because Michael and Darrell scared me a lot. So you just relax and watch this, okay?
Ellis stays first. There's Moroso in second. Remember that in fifth now, it is Rick Wilson. Darrell Waltrip has fallen to sixth. Running seventh is Rick Mast. Eighth is Harry Gant. Ninth is Dale Earnhardt. And tenth is Chuck Bound. 11th is Joe Bessie. I mean, a good run. A new name in NASCAR Motorsports. Are you watching the 17 car and the 75 right with him as they have their own little war going? 22 car. Rick Mast is there. That is Mast in the 22. Now back with number one. Here's Martin trying to move under Michael Waltrip. Oh, Morrow, number 30 slide. Give him a little tap going in.
Well, I'll tell you what, if possibly they just broke the car loose, they might have had a problem. You're so hard down in these corners, it's going to slip if you're going for a ride.
So, Michael Waltrip falling back. Mark Martin picking up the spot. Up in front, it's Ellis, Moroso, Martin now, the top three. Number 99 coming by. Ellis in front, number 25, Moroso in second, and the one car. Mark Martin now in that third position. 33 laps complete.
Ken Neal said earlier we had to get two lanes so we could really get racing. Well, now we're going to have to make two lanes because they've caught the slower cars, and I think this is the time that the real experienced drivers start to move.
Let's get a pit update. Here's Mike Joyce.
Well, the only concern among Bill Davis and his crew in the Mark Martin pit, Ken, is not that Mark may be pushing the car too hard. He's currently the quickest car on the racetrack, and it's not a question of how he's pushing it or will he get the lead. They think it's just a question of when.
A lot of time left in this one for that when. They're working the 36 of 200 laps. One caution has been thrown thus far. Chief starter here today, Bobby Scruggs. Back straightaway. Lining them up. And it looks like the car with the power right now is the number one of Martin. That Ford's running pretty well.
I'll tell you what, it seems like he's working awful good in the corners. He's trying people on the outside, the inside. He's made the moves that some of the other guys couldn't. He possibly could go right onto the front.
Rick Wilson stays fourth in the 75. Then Michael Waltrip has fallen to fifth. Rick Mast is in sixth. Harry Gant, winner at Darlington a week ago and defending champion of this event, maintaining seventh spot. Great crowd out here today at Richmond International Raceway. Paul Sawyer's personal celebration of speed, the old fairgrounds, really looks good, Neil.
I tell you what, they've done a great job. I've always liked to see them when they increase the facility and work on that, but they cater to the fans of this place. They've got nice facilities for them, good grandstands. I tell you what, we're putting on a quality show for them here now.
And it's live today on World Sports, the Commonwealth 200, as you watch Ellis, Moroso, Martin, the Waltrips, Wilson, Mast, Harry Gant, Dale Earnhardt, all fighting their way through this field. Dale Earnhardt is now up to ninth spot, and here's the man to watch, number 99. He's a two-time winner of this event, Tommy Ellis, who for years has owned the short tracks, particularly in the mid-Atlantic portion of America. Former national champion, won the Grand National Championship last year, took a shot at Winston Cup racing, liked this better, came back here. What a great accomplishment he had a year ago.
Well, I tell you, this thing's hard marked in one car. He's the only car I've seen that could drop back four or five positions and close it right back up in one lap. So that's a good indication that if he gets the chance, he could go right to the front.
The leader continues to be Ellis. Checking further back, Jack Ingram is now in 10th. Davey Allison, 11th. Chuck Bown has fallen to 12th. Joe Bessie has backed up into the 13th position. Elton Sawyer is 14th. Bobby Hamilton out of Nashville is running 15th. And the leading rookie on the Grand National Circuit, Kenny Wallace in St. Louis, Missouri, is in 16th position. Leader is number 99, Tommy Ellis, defending Grand National Champion, with Moroso in second, Martin third. We'll be back more live from Richmond in a moment.
Well, all the folks in this row have been cheering for Mark Martin as he marches his way up through the field. We're at Richmond International Raceway. Grand National action has been spectacular. A couple of neat things happened while we were away, and Ken's going to tell you about it now as we get back to it here in Richmond.
We are working lap number 47, David, and on lap 42, 43, this man, Mark Martin, out of Batesville, Arkansas, sprung to the inside, made a tremendous move, and moved around Moroso, and now watch this move for the lead. They're going down the main straightaway. They have a car in the midst of the track, number 74. That's Kelly Moore out of Maine. And it is the number one car, and dragging with him Moroso into second place. Falling to third is Ellis. Here's your new leader looking for his second win of the season. Mark Martin puts the Ford back out in front. Gentlemen, surprised?
Well, I think that's the crafty experience of Winston Cup racing, of catching people in traffic and using it.
Take a look at this scramble as you watch number one for a moment. A little further back to 30 and the 75. Rick Wilson is mixing it up with Michael Waltrip, you saw there. Here's Mark Martin again. Now the leader, number one. There's the 75 and 30. That's the battle for fourth spot. Rick Wilson, Michael Waltrip, and here comes Harry Gant.
I think Harry Gant's really been on the move, and what's funny about these three drivers right here is they all fly in the same airplane, and Harry owns the airplane, so they better be careful or they may be walking back to North Carolina.
They're closing on Ellison, the 99. Wilson. That was the Brad Teague ride, recall, that number 75 car for some time. Well, here's Wilson now, the Bartow, Florida campaigner, closing ground on Ellis on the outside. He brings with him Michael Waltrip and Harry Gant. Pass on the outside, 75 moving, high side of the racetrack, and Wilson swings around Ellis, and he brings car number 30 with him. Ellis off the pace here, Neil.
I tell you, Ken, we might see some of the strategy since he was made to have to do that. Mark's car was so strong, the one car, that when he took the lead, you could almost see a change in the strategy, his and Moroso's, that they're going to sit there and do like they said, run for the points. I don't think they're out of it. I think they're going to pace themselves now.
Let's go down to the pits with Mike Joy.
Bill Davis is the car owner and the crew chief on Mark Martin's car. And Bill, he's almost making it look too easy out there. He's having a super run.
Well, I couldn't quite hear what Ted said, but, you know, the car has just been great. He's perfectly happy with it. It's handled like it's supposed to, and hope it'll go the end of the race.
Now that he's out front, do you have any concern that he might be running it too hard trying to stretch out that lead?
Well, I don't really think so. He said the handle is just perfect. He's not looking for any problems. The tire so far has done a good job. We think we're okay.
That's Bill Davis.
And that is Mark Martin, who won that first race for Ford in Grand National ranks at Bristol. He has five Grand National victories to his credit, including 1987 here at Richmond. His size racetrack, he runs well on this size facility.
Mark has ran on short tracks for the past few years. Just a couple of years ago, he moved up to Winston Cup, got a good ride up there. But they're playing his game. We were talking earlier about the Busch Grand National and the Winston Cup guys. Mark Martin had been along since this was his bread and butter also.
He certainly grew up on this kind of racetrack in the ASA circuit, along with Rusty Wallace, some of those kind of drivers. And you're exactly right. He enjoys having Dale Earnhardt on a racetrack like this.
Right now, he has the field covered, and he has 20 car lengths on the second place man, Moroso. Here's the third place man, number 75. That's Rick Wilson. Right behind him, number 30, Michael Walton, Harry Gant in there. They move around to put a lap on car number 70, Jimmy Hensley out of Ridgeway, Virginia. Very well-liked driver, Hensley.
The thing I love about this kind of racing, if you're sitting home watching it on TV, you'd probably say, well, this thing's a walk-away. Caution comes out, then all of a sudden, someone else will run off. So the best racing is for second, third, fourth, and fifth. They're all locked right in together, and that's why Mark Martin's getting the runaway.
14 different winners in Grand National competition as we come to the 24th race of the season here at Richmond, Virginia. That speaks pretty well for competition, Neil.
Well, I tell you, these guys have got the circuit wound up. They've got the cars so close together. When somebody pulls away like this, I don't think so much that you had a lot of power or whatever. I think you had the car handling. The individual workmanship on the cars usually dictates who can pull away like this. So you really got that car handling.
Wilson down to the inside in the blue car, and the number 30, Waltrip, stays right with him as Gant just looks them over in number 7. A little early for Gant to make his move, isn't it, Neil? He usually is willing to loiter for a while, stay up in that lead lap, and put the halfway mark out, go for it.
Well, I tell you, Harry, just it's hard to get him excited, hard to get him in a hurry. He's going to lay back there. If that thing's capable of leave the first 10 laps, he'll do it. If not, he'll work his way up there. And every time I come to one of these Busch Grand National races, you just almost forget about Harry Gant, and then he's the guy about midway through or on that he's running away from the field. So you got to keep your eye on for him. He's not out of it by any means.
We were talking about the winners this year in Grand National competition. Just take a look at who's pulled off a checker thus far this season. Of course, Ellis, he's won three, as has Moroso, as has Spencer. But take a look down through here. You see a great combination of tracks here, like Louisville and South Boston and Pulaski County, Bristol, Tennessee, Dover, Daytona, Charlotte. It's such a great combination of courses that they run on.
I tell you what, it sounds like fun. I tell you, I used to run 60 or 80 short tracks a year. These guys are the backbone of the sport. These guys are trying to win races here, but their next step is Winston Cup, so they got a lot to prove. They run all over the country to do a good job of it.
growing larger and larger. It is the third racing class in America now. And money, over $3 million in the series, $100,000 up for grabs today. Look at Gant there in that number seven car, just trying to squeeze the trigger on Rick Wilson, 75, currently your third place runner.
Michael Waltrip made a great move going around his best friend, Rick Wilson, and he did pass him on the outside. So I do think we're going to start seeing a lot more side-by-side racing now.
Yeah, as they go along, they're going to have to, Johnny. These things, the tires start giving up a little bit. You get some heat in the tires now. The adhesion's not there on the bottom of the racetrack. And if you want to or not, you're going to have to get that outside lane. And the guy that can get the right groove working out there, he can be tough.
Now, wait a minute, Neil. Just when we started this broadcast, you were talking about turn two. Only one way to get through there, one lane. Now look at them. They're two abreast out there.
That's when you have a choice. When that choice is there, you'll make one lane. If somebody sticks that nose up under, you're going to have to figure it'll get way to get through there one way or the other. And I guarantee you there'll be a few tire marks on these cars before we're over here.
Here's Charlie Harville.
I'm in the pits of the Goo Muscle Racing team of Tommy Ellis, Mike Hillman, the crew chief. Mike, you started first and now made it back to seventh. What happened?
Well, we started the race a little bit too tight, started pushing. The right front tire went. It's gone away now. We just dropped back, being careful, waiting to get the Goo Goo Cluster Buick in to put some tires on it and get it back to the front.
That's Mike Hillman. The lady behind me is Brenda. She's keeping score.
Look at this struggle here. Michael Waltrip around the outside in the car number 30. And he's around Moroso in the 25. And here comes the 75, Rick Wilson, this campaign for second spot. Michael Waltrip, who was there and got knocked out of the spot, fell back to fifth. Roars back up to take second place. Robbie Moroso is pinned on the outside. Rick Wilson working him on the bottom of the racetrack.
The crafty old veteran, Harry Gant, going with Moroso, trying to get by his buddy Rick Wilson. So let's see if the crafty old veteran can pull it off. Oh, he did.
He's getting a crafty old dent in the side of it there off the 75 car, so it's getting interesting. I think you're seeing these guys right now. They've used up the good part of those tires, and they're racing on their ability right now. That outside lane gives you a little bit more room to slide. That seems like where they're working good now.
That's where you need a dirt tracker, and Gantz had that experience, too. Look at him. Rim ride on the outside, number seven, the white number seven in the fifth spot, Harry Gantz.
The only problem with that is that particular place they just exit the corner, you're dealing with about 6 inches of room there. That outside looks awful nice. But just the least bit of movement off that corner where you don't need to be, and they'll square the side of those race cars up.
Harry Gant is the man on the move. Flying up through the field. Currently being shown in third spot as Moroso falls to fourth. Back to fifth goes number 75, Rick Wilson. Masters in sixth. Tommy Ellis is in seventh. Darrell Waltrip is a steady eighth out here. In ninth, Dale Earnhardt. He's waiting his time. Going tenth. Is the car number 11, Jack Ingram. 11th is Bobby Hamilton. Joe Bessie back to 12th. He's picked up one spot. Moving around the lap car number 75, Fazendas of Hassanet, Massachusetts. This is in turns 3 and 4. Here's number 7, Gant in the third. Here's 75, Wilson up in there. Boy, Wilson is making a good run in this car.
I tell you, they're racing on a part of this racetrack that hasn't even been touched all week long. These tracks, when we come in here, are virtually clean and spotless, and there's no tire marks out there. They just keep moving that line over and over. They're racing on a particular part of the track that's never been touched all week, so it's a new area for them out there.
L.D. Ottinger about to go a lap down. His car number one, the blue Ford. Mark Martin stays first with 71 laps complete in the Commonwealth 200 at Richmond, Virginia.
200 Richmond International Raceway on a Saturday afternoon. Takes a pretty fair-sized kit to really be set to go to the races. You need your seat cushion, although everybody's been standing up all day watching the action. Cooler, all kinds of good cold things to drink in there. The action gets hot. You need a fan to keep yourself comfortable. The binoculars help you to see what's going on over on the far side of the racetrack. I got here a little bit too late. The chicken was all gone by the time I arrived. But the most important thing to have is somebody who's a whole lot of fun to enjoy the races with. Are you having fun here today?
Definitely.
We are too. Nice to be here for the action. The action has slowed down for just a moment. Let's go back to Ken Squire and find out what the yellow flag's all about.
Indeed, on lap 75, blown engine, Chuck Bound, car number 63, erupting down the back straightaway for the 35-year-old driver from Portland, Oregon. as his Pontiac expires. We go under our second caution of the day. That's only the second. He'll be the first retiree from the event. Chuck Bown losing an engine, and they're taking this opportunity to pit. From here, they can go home.
Well, I tell you, they're getting some work done in a hurry. Gant jumped in there and was right back out. His crew made a good stop, but these guys are putting those tires on. They just get two, as you said earlier, and they're sure going to feel good getting them on there.
150-mile race. The range is about 110 laps in this event, 110 miles in this event. So this is advantageous for them with 77 laps now on the board. Those leaders have been averaging about 114 miles per hour. They've lost just one car through the first 75 laps. Incredible competition.
After these pit stops, it'll be fun to watch because it's the strategy we're talking about early. Mark Martin lost about five or six spots with those stops, and he's going to have to work his way back to front. So it'll be interesting to see if he can be that dominant coming through as he was earlier.
Yeah, and when he came through there, I think, like I was talking about, he was the first guy to venture out there and try that new place, and a lot of the guys found what he did, and they're out there also. It's going to be interesting to see if he can work his way back in there.
As they line up on a restart, Harry Gant is now out in front. Remember, he won it a year ago over Larry Pearson in second, Robbie Moroso in third, Ellis in fourth, and Steve Grissom had a great day, the Gadsden, Alabama driver a year back, and finished fifth here. Gant now will have first and Michael Waltrip as they sort him out for a restart after we've had an engine unhinge on Chuck Bown's car. Bad break for the former winner of the Oxford 250, one of the biggest short track races in America.
Is this the same Gant that we were talking about a while ago that all of a sudden he just pops up and he's up here right in the front? And
the one.
Now, he might not have been a handful a while ago, but he's going to be sitting there now, and they're going to have to work to get around this man.
He's tough, isn't he?
He's tough, and the back of that car can be about 40 foot wide when you're leaving the race. You can pick the part of the real estate you want to use, and Harry's plenty capable of getting that thing around there in a hurry.
Mr. Whitaker builds them that way. Ed Whitaker's Buick, driven by Harry Gant, Taylorsville, North Carolina. 1988 Richmond Commonwealth 200 winner. Qualified 10th for today's race. Won at Darlington a week ago and has six Grand National wins to his credit. Lines up on the point in the white number 7 car.
We have one to go, Ken, and a couple cars really came close to getting lapped. Jack Ingram, one of the top people that's been running all day, did barely make it out.
Waltrip, in-car camera. Exxon Superflow car back in 8th spot as we get ready to go again. There's one that hides in the manger, too, and is apt to show up when things get toward the end, Neil.
Yeah, you know, you just almost forget about Darrell, and he's won so many races, and they said, where'd he come from? He came from a good ability to sit there and take care of that race car and use it when it was paid off, so he's still in there with them also.
Patience is a virtue. Here they are, down to the line. Old truism really holds solid in this kind of racing. On the start, everybody away clean into one. Get-go. Tommy Ellis rolls it around as he tries to come up on the outside.
It looks like the 30 car's got a little bit of problem on the restart back there wiggling around.
Falling back. He was up here on that start. Now he's dropping back. One, two, three. He's all the way back to like 6th spot. And I'll tell you who's on the move is Tommy Houston. Houston's beginning to show some strength here this afternoon. We'll get to him in a moment as we follow Harry Gant into the back straightaway. There is Tommy Houston, and he's up there with Michael Waltrip. What a run Tommy Houston has made. Remember, he qualified way back in this event, 25th. He's the current leader in the... Oh, he's one car getting almost sideways. Down here in one, picks it back up. There goes several of the cars beneath him. I think that was the car of Joe Thurman. Got a little loose.
It went front, right in front of Rob Moroso and stuck him by, and a couple cars got by, and boy, we have a wad coming here. They are really after each other.
Houston is in third spot in that shakeout. Second spot is the Ford. Mark Martin pulling up into second. Tommy Houston the third. Moroso falls to fourth. The zero car, McCabe getting lapped by everybody back there. Here's that leader, number 7, Gant. Down across the line comes Harry Gant. Then there's a lap car, L.D. Ottinger.
You know a wreck's going to take place in that group. You're just wondering when it's going to happen because they're just going 3 wide. Something's getting ready to happen big time here. Look at that wad of cars,
well,
Neil.
They've wrecked about 3 times. They just hadn't finished it yet. They will in a minute.
Unreal. Rick Mast in the 22, right up the middle, three wide all the way around the last lap. And the blue number 22 is there. And now you're with Darrell Waltrip. If they continue to sort him out.
What's hard to,
flying through traffic.
What's hard to believe about that is that's the part of racing that's fun. This, I know sitting up here, it looks crazy to see those guys three and four abreast, rooting and gouging around, but that's when racing is fun, when you feel like you've got control of that race car, making it do some things, and you see some things happening here.
Now you're with Waltrip in the 17 car, back in ninth. Look at him work his way on the bottom of the racetrack. Underneath the 75.
Oh, turn. We'll turn.
We got one car in the wall in turn number four. That's Kelly Moore out of Scarborough, Maine, who's going to bring out the third caution of the day.
I knew it was coming. I didn't know what lap, but I mean, people have been hitting on each other, pushing, shoving, and I just knew it was coming soon.
Well, the sheet metal is the cheapest part of these cars. Those tires, those motors are expensive. You can bang that metal up all day long.
Grand National North runner, third up there in their standings these days. Kelly Moore out of Scarborough, Maine. Car is entered by his wife, Roxanne Moore. Comes to knot in turn number three. We collect the third yellow of the day with 87 laps now complete in the Commonwealth 200. It's a dandy. It's live here today. Stay with us. They're brooming down turn number three, where Kelly Moore of Scarborough, Maine, has brought out our third caution of the day as the field is working the 90th lap. Harry Gant continues out in front. Let's get this report from Mike Joy.
Ken, an update on attrition. Jimmy Spencer, who started from the pit lane after the field got the green, was the first car out of the race. They think they spun the bearings and had a complete engine failure on his machine. Elton Sawyer, the Chesapeake, Virginia driver, dropping out with a burned piston. Chuck Bound, the Nescafe car, said the transmission just exploded on him as he came down the straightaway. Steve Grissom's had a lengthy pit stop. They've changed carburetors on his Texas Pete car. That has not solved the problem. And now Kelly Moore is on pit road trying to repair crash damage.
Preparing for a restart. This time by will go under green with Gant first. Mark Martin's number one in second. Tommy Houston from 25th up to third. Robbie Moroso in fourth. Rick Mast in fifth. Rick Wilson is in sixth. Darrell Waltrip seventh. Michael Waltrip eighth. Dale Earnhardt is ninth. Bobby Hill in tenth. Kenny Wallace 11th. Davey Allison 12th. Kenny Burke's 13th as we get ready to roll once again around the three-quarter mile Richmond International Raceway. Great afternoon. A wonderful race thus far.
Ken, Harry Gant had trouble coming up to speed on the restart a few seconds later, earlier. So let's see if he does that and has a problem, because L.D. Ottinger might get that lap back.
Coming to the stripe, Gant trying to get a jump. Saw the start, 17, Walter's car. And as they fly down into turn number one, Gant off to a good start this time. You see those front three lap cars are up on the high side. Cars in the lead lap on the bottom of the racetrack on that start. Back straightaway, the seven. The Buick stays in front of the Ford, and here comes the Ford down to the inside. Charging at a turn number four, number one. Makes a run. Mark Martin motors to the bottom of the racetrack. Harry Gant on the high side into turn number one. It's Mark Martin pushing that Ford back into the lead. Meanwhile, number six, Tommy Houston and his Buick creeps ever closer. Leader, number one, Martin Gant back to second in turn four. 93 laps complete this time by. You see the front of the field, those are the front three, and here comes Tommy Houston looking low. The old Southern Biscuit number six. Sounds like you need Garrison Keillor to do an announcement about that car. They're going to switch sponsors next year. They'll be with Roses for Tommy Houston, who is currently number one in the standings by just 15 points over Tommy Ellis. 115 points separate the top five. There you see that six car working on Gant.
Ken, I think everybody in the points battle thought this was their opportunity to make a move on Tommy. He qualified well back in the pack, and everybody said he's off the pace, but it sure doesn't look like it right now.
Battle ensuing for second spot, and look at this number seven car taking the high line. Houston, the number six, who pulls up on the bottom of the racetrack. Tommy Houston away in the second spot, ready to challenge the fourth to lead. And look at this grand. Here's the 75. Rick Wilson holding Moroso high. Waltrip clambering up through into seventh.
This is fun. Look at the Waltrip brothers side by side pushing on each other. Ms. Waltrip, don't you watch this stuff.
Here's Darrell down to the inside.
Darrell's being ugly to Michael, Ms. Waltrip.
Darrell Waltrip pinning his brother on the outside. Moroso comes out a little sideways just behind this number 17 car. Waltrip clambering up through now, making a run on the 75 car. Rick Wilson, you're riding with Darrell Waltrip as he closes up another time with our live coverage here today of the Commonwealth 200. Look at those cars bob and weave.
You know, I tell you, looking on the camera here, he's got better shocks on this car than I do. Mine bounces around a little bit. That camera must be on some, a little bit of suspension travel there.
I tell you, that Rick Mast is really making a move. Number 22 car just jumped under Tommy Houston.
Tommy Houston falling back as Mast pulls up, goes into third. Rick Wilson right with him, and Darrell Waltrip. Boy, they swap every lap out here. Here's the number 22 coming to halfway.
On a deal like that, Neil, he drives right by Harry Gant, pulls up, and then all of a sudden four cars drive by you.
Well, when that race restarted, those tires are nice and cool. After this thing balances out with hot tires, the guys that have got the chassis right will come to the front.
Scramble for third. Mast and 75 deadlock. Waltrip right with them. Halfway this time by. 100 down, 100 to go. Look at this fight. Ooh, give him another fender. Full contact stock car racing, and here comes Waltrip to the inside. They're three deep now as Waltrip tears to the bottom of the racetrack, finds the hole. Number 17 diving down low. He gets number 75. Wilson goes for number 22. Rick Mast. What a run by Waltrip as they stacked them three wide out of turn four. Darrell Waltrip, bottom of the racetrack. Rick Mast. Tremendous runner, this Mast of the 22.
Well, we got so many good races all around this racetrack, we can't cover them all, but I'm telling you, these guys are getting after each other.
I tell you, Darrell and Earnhardt have the Chevrolet V6s. Most of the other cars had the Buick V6s with a one Ford V8 V6 up front, so looks like Walter's little V6 is working pretty good in the Chevrolet.
That A.G. Dillard car, number 22, stays right there. 17 peels to the bottom of the racetrack another time. Mast is 32 years old and a great driver. You know, his father-in-law owns a race car. Old racing Virginia family. Number 17. Back comes Waltrip again. Back comes the Waltrips again. 17 and 30. Michael right there with him. 22. Rick Mast, the blue white numeral car, who qualified 13th in his 190th start. Hangs right in there for third spot as Mark Martin continues to lead. Gantz is second. Look at this fight. 22 is there, 75, and back comes Waltrip on the inside. 17 down to the bottom. Here's Tommy Houston getting edged a little by Bobby Hamilton in the 81, and Waltrip up in front is trying to again on the bottom of the racetrack. Darrell Waltrip trying under that 75. Look at this fight. Here he is. Ah, looks like he put a wheel into him.
Yeah, you know, going that corner, it's just hard to keep a car down. And that little bit of contact there is just normal on a track. Like, if you stick it under, it doesn't stick. But you've got to try it. You've got to put it in there so the car stays on the bottom.
Darrell Waltrip has a good bite on the bottom of the racetrack. Seems to run lower and stronger there than anybody else at the moment.
Well, he stayed there longer than anyone has. It works the motor a little bit harder, has to really strain up off the corner. But that thing is working good. Here comes old Mikey. He's going to try it a while.
And yeah. Rick Wilson trying the bottom for a moment.
Let's see if Mikey helps his brother or helps Rick Wilson. Now, that'll be interesting because he and Rick are best friends. Well, he helped Rick Wilson.
I think he helped Mikey. You check it out.
Yeah.
Darrell Waltrip in fifth. Correct that. Michael Waltrip now in fifth. Darrell falls to sixth. Seventh is Moroso. Eighth, Bobby Hillen. Up to ninth comes Earnhardt. Tenth is Tommy Houston. Remember, he came all the way up in there. Tommy now falls back into the 10th position. Running 11th, Bobby Hamilton. 12th, the rookie Kenny Wallace. 13th, Davey Allison. 14th, Kenny Burks. 15th is Ronald Cooper. And then Tom Peck is 16th. So that's how they sugar it off here at 108 laps complete in the Commonwealth 200 as Mark Martin looks for his second Ford V6 win. As $103,000 at stake, but these guys would race for a nickel. It's the Grand National Competition at Richmond International Raceway, live from World Sports. And you're watching Mark Martin out of Arkansas, currently leading with Harry Gant in second. That number 71 car going a lap down is Clark. Rick Wilson is in third, Michael Waltrip fourth, Rick Mast is in fifth, Darrell Waltrip sixth, Bobby Hamilton seventh, Robbie Moroso eighth, Dale Earnhardt ninth, and Kenny Wallace tenth as we come to 115 laps complete. Looks like about 30,000 folks are out here to see it, and we've just had a tremendous snarl. We had a fire break out here between 22 and 75. The 75 car, Rick Wilson, the 22, and watch this for full contact sport.
Yeah, they both wanted to have right away. Here they go down in the corner. Rick carried him a little bit. Rick Wilson in the 75 went out a little wide. The 22 came up here and kind of blow the horn at him right here. These things don't have horn buttons. They sure got a nice bumper on the front of them. There it goes. I think he got the point, and then it took about another lap for him to settle it down again. It's a good thing they both painted blue.
Just well, a few a wrinkles shade there. Of blue.
Oh, yeah, but not near as blue as their faces right now.
So that's the Saturday afternoon forward pass as pulled off by Rick Mast in car number 22 here in the Commonwealth 200 just moments ago. And they struggled in third position. Wilson of the 75 is now there. Now watch Earnhardt in the number three as he begins to unlimber that car entered by his wife, Teresa Earnhardt, moving around the 36 or attempting to here. Going down into turns three and four. Kenny Wallace, the leading rookie, going a lap down. The Cox-treated lumber car of Kenny Wallace getting caught up here as the man in black paces himself, and look who's right with him. Number 99 is there, Tommy Ellis, man that set on the pole. Three times a winner. Look at Kenny Wallace scramble. Car owned by his brother, Rusty Wallace.
Yeah, and that's Rusty's baby brother and wants to grow up and be just like him. I said, man, I don't know if the world's big enough for two of you guys.
Yeah, there's Earnhardt running Teresa's car around. If he scratches that thing up, he's going to be in trouble.
Of course, he rolled it up in a ball about big enough for a cocktail table at Daytona when he went in.
That's about a joke. Earnhardt scratching a car. I wouldn't think he'd ever do that, would you?
And he climbed right out, went out and practiced in another car in about 20 minutes. Unbelievable. Mark Martin stays first, Gant second, Wilson third here. There's that leading rookie, number 36, Kenny Wallace. And here comes, number 99 down to the inside, Tommy Ellis, going for ninth spot, and Ellis is there. Ellis working his way back up into this race.
Yeah, you know, he said he was going to pace himself, and it's past the pacing time now. He's going to have to make a move up there. It's just going to have to see if that car is capable of working his way back to the front.
99 needs another caution badly because the field has a lot of interval now. He's almost a half of a lap down back in ninth as Mark Martin continues to stay first. Martin, present time, has about 22 car lengths over Harry Gant in second. Rick Wilson is in third, and those leaders have some interval on them right now.
The Davey Allison car slowed on the backstretch. It's coming into the pit.
Well, that's unfortunate for Davey, who's still looking for a fourth V6 victory for his team. Davey Allison, the Texaco Antifreeze, car number 28, the 28-year-old driver from Hueytown. He's just had one top five finish this year, and that was fifth up at Nazareth, Pennsylvania. Caution out! Yellow is on the track.
The 02 car bounced off the wall and got it going back in the right direction, so I think he's okay.
May have dropped some pieces, so we're under caution once again as car number 02 had itself a problem out here today. Kenny Burks Buick out of Stewart's Draft, Virginia, got the fourth caution.
This is exactly what Tommy Ellis and several of those boys are looking for, because this is getting to shootout time.
You know, Davey just having that problem just before the caution came out. They just owned one V6 motor. Robert Yates built that engine, and it was the only one in captivity, so Davey might have to put a set of pedals in that thing to finish.
Kenny Burks bringing out this caution period, giving the field time to congregate under a caution flag up in front, and we'll be back with more of the action. There's plenty of it at Richmond this afternoon live.
North Carolina.
We're back live. It's the Commonwealth 200 Richmond International Raceway in Virginia. I want to talk about the progress in stock car racing. These guys used to be late model sportsman drivers, raced on Saturday night for $100. Now the series is worth $3 million, and it's called Grand National Racing. But that's not the progress I want to talk about. What I want to talk to you about is the days when I started going to racetracks. What were you going to eat? You were going to eat a track dog, and that was a cold weenie in a stale bun. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you progress in stock car racing. Hot Italian sausage with peppers and onions on a fresh bun, and it only cost me $5, and that included the Coke and the napkin. That's progress. Back to you, Kevin.
The man ain't right. The man ain't right. You know, he uses big words when he talks to us, and then all of a sudden he falls in with those people. There's two people living inside of that man's body, Ken.
Dave to Spain with our culinary report today.
I'd get five for one of those myself right now.
Getting set on a restart, and here's what's happened. Moroso and Gant have pitted, and they're now on the bottom end of the lineup. They're all the way in the back as they get set to go. There you see the 7 and the 25 out back. Mark Martin is in front. Rick Wilson second. Michael Waltrip third. Rick Mast is fourth. Bobby Hamilton is up to fifth after he qualified way back in this race, 29th. His best finish thus far was second up in Nashville. See what Bobby Hamilton's going to do today. Eighth is Wallace. Ninth is Earnhardt on this restart. Number 99, Tommy Ellis, is seventh on this start. Here you see him, and some trouble. One car all the way to the wall, gets it back as they roll out and get underway. Car number one in the lead. That number 99 car got taken and held, stop and go penalty for crossing the yellow line coming out of the pits, and that's why that 99 disappeared for a while. But he's coming back. He's up on Bobby Hamilton right now in the eighth. There you see the 22 just in front of them, Rick Mast. Fourth, fifth.
Whoa, back stretch.
Back straight away. Michael Waltrip gets spun. He was in there with the 22, lies not quite in the center of the track, and everybody's getting by, but yellow is out.
He's going to not even lose a lap. Great job by Michael, but boy, he dodged a bullet. Cars were coming from everywhere. I think he and Rick Mast got together, and boom, he went around.
And Mast is already on pit road with his right front fender missing on car number 22. Let's take a look in replay at what happened and have Neil Bonas tell us about it.
Well, they came off the second turn back there. This is a different area right here. They were running real close together. Here's the 99 car making a move on here. Here's the 22 did get in with Mikey. They got hung up right there. I noticed the left front fender got off Mike's car. And from there on, that's one of those deals you close your eyes and mash that little pedal in the middle and see if you can get stopped. Thank goodness everybody went around him on both sides.
So both the 22 and the 30 sustained some damage. 30 is back out. It's crumpled a little. The 22 is missing fender. They're in with a hood up on Rick Mast's car, which is running fourth when that took place. That was a third and fourth place shunt.
It seems like after every restart, what's happened on this thing is that a lot of guys didn't change tires. Those tires run about 230, 240 degrees of tire temperature. When you slow down on the caution, it actually picks up the rubber that's laying on the racetrack. And when you restart, it takes about a lap or two to clean that old worn out rubber off there, the debris off of the racetrack. And for about two laps, you see all those guys sideways, and they just got hung up coming off that corner.
Here's Mike Joy.
Ken, they're using a tool that looks like a baseball bat to wedge between the fender and the tire to get Mike Waltrip enough tire clearance. They're also going to change the left front. The metal edge of the fender was bent in against it, so as a precaution, they'll get that done and get him in and out before the pace car brings the field back around. A little hammer work, too. On that last caution, only a couple of cars came in and made pit stops. Harry Gant got left side tires among the front runners because most everyone else, including leader Mark Martin, and figured they could go the distance on the gas they had since they stopped for fuel at lap 78.
We're one lap away. One lap away from getting a restart, Mike. Have a tire rule in here today, and I think that's a dandy idea because those tires can absolutely financially destroy teams.
Well, I tell you, they've got a deal here where you can change one tire in all positions on the car. Any other time, it's a penalty to do it. In turn, it makes all these guys, the low-budget teams, be able to race hand-in-hand. These things are $200 a piece. It's not a lot of fun sticking a bunch of them on there.
That's one free tire change at each tire position in a caution period. You can change under green, but it really cuts down on the number of tires these people use.
When I used to race at this level, Ken, we'd come in and the it was just a natural on the tire stop to put four on because the other guy did it. And you had to, if you were going to race with him, you had to do it this way. It puts everybody on equal ground with a little bit of used rubber.
Getting set for a start, and it also puts them into a little edge work here.
They change it. They're going to have one more lap.
Going to take one more before they turn them loose. Here's Charlie Harvin.
Tommy Houston benefited greatly from the previous caution flag. He had a tire going down on the left side, and they had to bring him into the pit to change tires. The caution came out just before he came to the pit, so he did not lose a lap. He had to make two other stops so they could check the air pressure on the right side of the car. They're having a little problem with Steiger now.
There you see the Houston car, number six, as it rolls out here and tries to stay on top in Grand National Racing.
I know they were giving one to go, and I noticed Mike Walter going out of pit road, and they turned the stop sign on him. And he ran the stop sign on him. I think they're going to make him come back in.
There he is, number 30, around the racetrack and trying to catch the field.
You know, you come down pit road running 110 miles an hour and race switch up paddle, it's not easy to stop that car that quick.
You can see the flag man hitting his button, talking up at the top, but his number hadn't shown up yet, so he might have dodged a bullet.
Martin first, Wilson second, Bobby Hamilton third, Darrell Waltrip fourth, Kenny Wallace fifth, Tommy Ellis sixth, Dale Earnhardt seventh, Jack Ingram eighth, Moroso in ninth, Gant is in tenth. They turn him loose. And number 30 had the pit.
He's coming down for a stop and go. And he did it smartly. This way he can go and not lose the lap. Whoa, he might have choked the car.
Missed. Trying to get him fired, and it's not working for number 30. He's finally away. Real problem for Michael Walter. He might get a lap down here. He's trying to get back on the track. You see him just exiting pit road at number 30, and here come the leaders barreling into turn number one. He's back to speed. Here's the one car in front, Mark Martin with Rick Wilson in second place.
Well, I'm sure Mark Martin needs to see that because Mike, it'll be hard to get around Mike.
Darrell Waltrip up to fourth spot, and directly in front of him is Bobby Hamilton in the eight, who's making a tremendous run. Meanwhile, take a look up here. Here's the 75, Rick Wilson.
Ooh.
Down to the bottom, and he uses up some sheet metal as he goes beneath car number one, and Hamilton, the youngster in number eight, is up in there trying to get through. Battle for second spot. Take a look at this. Bobby Hamilton, best finish to date was his home track. He was the former track champion. Hamilton in the eight, running wheel to wheel with Mark Martin. And Hamilton picks up another spot. This is the guy that we talked about earlier this season that we thought we were going to see a lot more of. And look at him out here mixing it up right now with Mark Martin. Great struggle for second place. Meanwhile, Wilson's trying to run off and hide.
Rick flat slam dunked him going into turn one, moved him up. Hamilton could not get by. They fall back in line. But I tell you, somebody else in the racetrack is flying to the front is Tommy Ellis. He is making his move quickly.
Yeah, Mark Martin's strong suit has seemed to be, after they've run several laps, he's been able to stretch it out. It's going to be interesting to see if his car comes back to him and he's able to move up after they get the tires getting hot again.
Rick Wilson in the 75 car, staying out in front by 12 car lengths. What's the toughest part of this track for Rick Wilson?
I would say 3 and 4 would be the toughest, because you can really overdrive that corner. You can go in too hard, and you get up to marbles, and you see a lot of people spin out there. And then they've got a bad hazard coming off of 4, which is a pit wall, and it's sticking right out at you. You know, we try to run, the groove is to run as close to that pit wall you can. If somebody touches you there, you get loose and you hit a solid cement wall. So that's the one that bothers me the most.
Rick Wilson, twice a winner this year at Bristol, Tennessee, and Dover, Delaware, going for win number 3 this season.
And you know what I love about that interview? He said the exact opposite of my expert commentator, Neil Bonnet. He said a blind hog could drive through 3 and 4, and my man Rick said that's the worst place to get through.
Well, I'm going
to
pick my own place as well. Rick, he can have his own place.
Wilson stays first, Martin second. Bobby Hamilton in the number 8 car with an outstanding run stays right up in third.
Harry Gann is on his way. He's starting to work his way through quickly, so he and Jack Ingram all of a sudden starting to run good too, and Robbie Moroso, and they're all hooked up together and coming toward the front.
Tommy Ellis is now up to fourth in the 99, and here is the number 7 car up to 8 moves Harry Gann. There are 142 of 200 laps now complete.
They're showing Gant here now on the last caution. Gant and the 25 car Moroso were the only ones to stop for tires, and it's showing up right now.
Look at him around the number 3. Earnhardt on the bottom in seventh, and Gant just says, see you later, fella.
What he really said was, Dale, I can't believe I'm smarter than you and took left sides, and you're just out here sliding around. I'll catch you later, my man.
Teresa might not be giving Dale all the tires he wants. She owns that thing. She might have cut him back on the tire bill.
Yeah, they're tight on money.
Here's Charlie Harville.
Here's Rick Mast, who is behind the wall. Rick, are you trying to get back in the race?
I don't know. Today was indicative of my season. You know, you get up front, you run up front, you know, you get ready for the end of the race, you try to hold back, save your car, save the tires, getting ready for the last part of the race, and loose, quick. I don't know, Michael got a little loose off the second corner, and we bumped, and when we bumped, my car cut off, and we haven't gotten the tires yet.
We got a crash down at turns number 3 and 4. Caution is out. 3 cars were involved. It was a car number 9, Bessie, 66, Ling, 81, Hillen was in that thing, and I believe the 96 was also involved. Tom Peck out of McConnellsburg, Pennsylvania, got a piece of that one. There you see 96 Peck. He has slid down the track from where it began. Let's take a look at it again, gentlemen. Away we go to the races here. There's Bessie in the 9 car sliding. Ooh.
Right there in the middle of the groove, and when something happens there, it's just going to stack everybody up.
I think that's Hillen's 81. He gotten a big piece of that one. And Ling in the 66. So we're under caution for another time here today. That's the 6th caution of the day as car number 96, Tom Peck, heads back into the pits. More live action from Richmond shortly.
Promotional consideration and fee paid by Exxon Superflow Motor Oils. Go with the flow, Superflow.
Racetrack t-shirt here at Richmond International Raceway. And in fact, the shirts that folks wear to the races say an awful lot about their lifestyle. Let's give you a little sample. This one, got to be a Dallas Cowboy fan, right? And I would presume that this might be a souvenir of the last vacation that this guy took. Favorite restaurant? Well, sure, we know where this guy likes to eat. Likes them oysters. But of course, most of these shirts make some sort of an automotive statement. Let me just walk right down here and ask this fella right here, would you really rather push a Ford than drive a Chevy?
Absolutely.
No doubt about it.
No doubt about it.
Who's going to win this race today?
Number one.
He's pulling for a Ford today, ladies and gentlemen. Let's go back outside with Ken Squire.
All right, we're ready on a restart with 148 of 200 laps complete. Coming down to the line, under green, the number 75, the Charlie Henderson car, the Food Country machine of Rick Wilson from Bartow, Florida. For win number 3, streaking out, and car number 7 is back in this thing serious, big time for Harry Gant. He's up to 7th spot on the shuffle. Number 1, Martin right there in 2nd spot.
Waltrip's falling to the inside.
Darrell Waltrip off the pace. Looks like he's pitting. Waltrip, who had been running 5th in car number 17, glides on the pit road.
That made that gentleman with Dave Despain very happy, didn't it?
Just to hurt him.
He gets an opportunity to push a Chevrolet.
Bobby Hamilton, look at young Hamilton, running in the 3rd spot in car number 8.
Here comes Mark Martin back after him again.
Now, what do you do in a situation like this, Neil? The 75 car slammed him going into this same turn. Does he return the favor now?
Well, we'll just get to see here in a lap or two, but I don't think he forgot what happened earlier.
What an exciting Grand National race we're having live for you at Richmond. Our next live race will be at Charlotte, North Carolina, Saturday, October 7th. Grand National moves on September 16th to Dover, Delaware. Then September 23rd, Martinsville, Virginia. October 7th, Charlotte, North Carolina. And you'll see it right here. To go some to beat this one. This has been a damn. Look at 99 working on number 8. That's Ellis trying to get up under Bobby Hamilton as Rick Wilson continues to stay in front in his 11th Grand National race of the year, the blue number 75. And take a look at number 8. Here is Bobby Hamilton from Nashville, Tennessee, holding on the hometown favorite, Tommy Ellis at Richmond, number 99, and that next position back fourth.
Tommy Ellis is looking at that yellow rookie bumper, and he's sitting there saying, what is this guy doing outrunning me in my hometown? I got to do something about this.
5 lead changes among 5 drivers, and look at this scramble. Down to the inside comes that 99 to give you a review back through the field. Some of the positions further back. Up in front, 75 and 1, really get the business.
Well, I tell you, Mark Martin's car seemed to work good after he gets those tires hot. But Wilson's awful strong up that straightaway.
And guess who's back there? The crafty old veteran has moved up into fifth place. Harry Ginn.
Poe, Wilson leans on 75 and loses ground. And number 99, Ellis is there. Tommy Ellis, who fell way back, got penalized in the race, crossing that yellow line, you see, as he came out of the pits. He's worked his way back up to contend with 155 laps complete. 200 laps the distance, and number 99, Ellis, is on a march.
That's a perfect example. He didn't know how to body slam him. He wasn't far enough up, and he almost turned himself when he hit him.
Way too polite.
Yeah, you got to hit him sideways and hit him hard, Mark.
99 down to the inside on Mark Martin, Tommy Ellis. Martin on the outside from Arkansas, and Richmond, Virginia's Tommy Ellis on the inside in turn three. The 99 pressing down to the bottom, and the Buick and the Ford still in there tight together.
Okay, Hamilton in that eight car is doing an excellent job.
Take a look at this.
Watch him about turn himself. Rick saw him coming up in him, so I think he just pulled down on him.
Mark's coming down
75,
on the inside.
Rick Wilson.
Here comes Mark coming in. The one car is coming down pit road.
Mark Martin may have caught a tire down on car number one. He is on pit road. Dick McCabe coming in just in front of him in the zero car. Here's McCabe in, and Mark Martin's number one also in. And here's car number seven. That is Harry Gant now up to fourth.
Right front tire only.
Let's go to Mike Joy.
As Mark Martin pulls out of the pits after a tire change, Darrell Waltrip is behind the wall. Darrell is short, but a hot day at the office.
Well, we made it three-fourths of the way. I don't know, something happened to the motor on that race start. Took off, and all of a sudden it went down on the cylinder. If you got eight cylinders, you can run on seven, but if you only got six cylinders, it's kind of hard to run on five, so we decided to pull it in, and it broke something in the motor, but the Exxon Chevrolet was running good today.
Well, Rick Wilson, Tommy Ellis, you've raced against them all today. Who's got the shot?
Well, I thought Mark did. He looked the strongest, but his tires have given up on him. Right now, I guess Rick's about the toughest one out there. Tommy's coming on pretty good, too.
That's Darrell Walton.
Here you see the leader. 75, Rick Wilson. Darrell Waltrip waits another day. We'll see him in Charlotte, North Carolina on Saturday, October 7th. Try another time. Here is that one car that's now a lap down. The 99, Ellis, is your second place runner, trying to move around the lap car of Mark Martin and finding room out of turn number two.
That makes it tough. They had to just change one tire with that flat, and they just put a right front tire, and it really makes that car hard to drive like that.
Who do you think's up for the Goodies Headache Award today, Neil?
I don't know if they've got enough goodies to go around. We've got a few bent-up race cars here.
Here's 99 Ellis in the second spot. $103,000 at stake. 162 of 200 laps are now complete. Rick Wilson with the same car, the same crew that Brad Teague used to drive, looking for his third win of the season. Has a four-way tie for most wins this season. He stays out there and does it. Gets his third win, as has Moroso, as has Ellis and Spencer. Now there's that eight. That's Bobby Hamilton, who is having a race and a half today. What a job he's done, but he's about to be challenged. Up on the outside, the white number seven going around number one. Here comes Harry Gant. Gant is in fourth spot, ready to challenge Hamilton. There's been a challenge among those top six drivers throughout the entire event.
Gant sitting on the freshest rubber out there, too. Him and Moroso were the guys that put on left side that last stop, so that thing might start showing up in a minute.
But Moroso's back in sixth spot, and he has fallen almost 3 seconds behind Harry Gant. Gant got the jump in traffic, and Moroso's still trying to find his way.
Well, I think that's the experience of working race traffic, and I think that's one of the things Moroso will learn and have to learn next year to compete in the Winston Cup level.
On a short track like this, you've got to be up there and make that move on that restart, Neil, or you are lost.
Yeah, the cars are so evenly matched that you can make a move and pass three or four cars in a little bit of a jam, but just to run them down individually one at a time and make up a second or two is awful tough to do.
Here's number 25. Spain in sixth position, the average speed 114.31 miles per hour on the leader in the last lap. That's Rick Wilson, 75. Here you see Moroso. Remember that this is your sixth place man. Dale Earnhardt is now in seventh. Earnhardt is in seventh. Jack Ingram, eighth. Ronald Cooper is ninth. And running tenth is Tommy Houston. out in front, it remains number 75, Wilson. Hamilton stays third. We'll have more in a moment. 400 feet at the exit of turn four. Unfortunate for Harry Gant, winner at Darlington a week ago. Out of it here today. And the number 75, the Rick Wilson car, has also been damaged. It lies down here, does not crank up. You can see right front and left rear damage on the Charles Henderson Oldsmobile driven by Rick Wilson. Let's see what happens.
It looked like something broke on the car up front. There's Gant coming in afterwards. Rick had already spun up in front of him. Gant got in something on the racetrack and backed it in the wall. The car came off the wall and burst into flames. Thank goodness for the fuel cells with the check valves that shut off the bulk of the fuel. It's kind of, it's more of a flash fire initially, and then the thing goes down some. But it looked like as Rick entered that corner, something happened. He turned around. He might have broke something on that car, and then Gant ran into it.
Another view.
Here we go. Here's Wilson sideways up front. He was leading very comfortably. Something broke on that car. Something came out from under it, and he put some in the groove. And I think we'll see Gant come into that next.
Gant's behind it by about 300 feet.
But something did happen to Rick's car initially that set off the deal for Harry to run it back in.
And when the 75 spun, you saw how close it was for Ellis. That's key here. Ellis missed by about a foot. They say that car 02 was putting down some oil. That was the Kenny Burke's car.
Okay.
And the 02, the oil coming out of it, caught Rick Wilson, who we see clambering out of his machine, over the wall and out of the race after this just terrific race he made today. Car number 75 up there on the track. It's done.
Yeah, I knew when you turned in that corner, the car just turned around him all of a sudden. It had to be something, either his car or something on the track, because he had no control of it.
We'll be back with a word with Rick Wilson and Harry Gant shortly here at the Richmond International Raceway, where 174 of 200 laps are complete, and Bobby Hamilton of Nashville is now the leader. At 176 laps, we have a red condition at the Richmond International Raceway in our live World Sports coverage. What has happened is that we have a complete oil down around the track. As you see, car number 7, the rear end totally gone from Harry Gant's car. Here's what happened. The 02, Kenny Burke's, blew an engine coming out of 4, and he went all the way around the track, leaking oil out of his Buick, and put it right in the line. The first man to be collected was apparently the 75 car. The second was the 7 car right here. Gets in the oil, and away goes car number 7. At about the same moment, the 75 was spinning and crashing, and so two of the leaders are taken out because the car leaking oil was running around the track, and they've had to bring this race to a halt to bring out the safety crews to cover the complete line all the way around the track.
Well, I'll tell you, Harry Gant hit that wall a shot. Here we have Rick Wilson coming around, and Rick's the first car that get in. He's comfortably leading the race. Looks like he has them covered. Goes into turn 3. Everything seems to be working fine. Then watch how fast this thing swaps in. It just touches that oil and goes straight around. He has nothing to do. Harry Gant, right behind him now, does the same thing. He was lucky enough not to hit the wall as hard as Harry did. Harry really tore his car up.
Just a wonder that some others didn't get caught in that oil, too.
You know, an excellent move right there. The 8 car, Hamilton, you know, the 99 car had to slow down. He moved around there. He's in the lead, and he's shown the capabilities. He might be tough to get around in this race on the restart.
Here's Mike Joy.
Rick Wilson, one thing about the unpredictability of the sport, it makes it great for the fans, but for fellas leading the race, it's something else again. One minute you're leading the race, and the next minute you're standing here and your car is a mess.
Yeah, that's true. You know, it's a bad deal. Somebody blowed or whatever, and going in 3 there, you know, when we got there, there it was. And, you know, I spun back the car in the wall, and there's some other cars, but you know, the food control was running good. And we had the race in the bag pretty well. We were just sitting there cruising, and I knew Tommy was coming, so I was slacking off a little bit, saving my tires, wait for the end of it. So, you know, everybody's okay. I just want to tell my wife I'm okay, and yeah, we had a good run today.
I know you don't get much clear ice on the road down in Bartow, Florida, but when you hit an oil slick like that, is that kind of the same feeling?
Yeah, that's exactly what it is. You know, you get on ice, you get on oil, just like getting on ice. You can't do anything with it. It's going to go straight up to the fence, and just hopefully you can back into it, or if you can light the tires up and maybe slow it down some, that's all you can do.
Okay, so Rick is okay. We've also got word that Harry Gant also is all right. Both these fellas, though, are out of the race and have that long walk back to the garage instead of to victory lane.
24 laps remain, Mike, before this one's over. And the car number 8 becomes the key player, Bobby Hamilton, the Filbert Martucci car, Lightning 7 fans Buick, out of Nashville, Tennessee. 1987 Nashville track champion, now is on the point. He's got his hands full with Tommy Ellis in second. Kenny Wallace, the leading rookie candidate of 1989 in Grand Nationals, up to third. Robbie Moroso's in fourth. Jack Ingram is in fifth. Earnhardt is in sixth. Tommy Houston is seventh. Ronald Cooper, eighth. Mark Martin, ninth, a lap down. Front eight are in the lead lap. Martin is in ninth, a lap down. L.D. Ottinger will be 10th. Randy LaJoy from Connecticut will be 11th. Michael Waltrip will be 12th, and Bobby Hillen 13th when they get set on a restart, which we expect will be very, very shortly. The field just about organized down here in turn number one, waiting for them to turn them loose.
It looks like the biggest problem, Ken, is this track is so large now, I don't think the truck could physically carry enough oil dry to put down totally around this racetrack, and I'm telling you, he put it from one end to the other.
One thing sets Tommy Ellis apart from the pack of Grand National Championship contenders, the title they're all chasing. Tommy already has taken them. Tommy Ellis, he's a throwback to a time when men went about the sport of stock car racing with little concern for public image or marketing position.
I'm certainly no pretty boy. I'm pretty self-made. I believe in doing things my way. It's been successful for me to a point, and it's hurt me to a point.
Ellis's way of doing things nearly brought his driving career to an end. A former Grand National champion, he spent three unproductive seasons in Winston Cup racing before an angry falling out with his car owner left him sidelined in 1987. Ready to quit. Then the phone rang with an offer from Grand National car owners John Jackson and Bill Papke that changed everything.
They came to me when I was down and out, didn't have anything, and we got together, and they saw that I had the talent, and they thought that I could win races.
In 88, Ellis won three races and his second Grand National Championship. This year, he's in the thick of it again, due largely to his gift with a rough and tumble of the short tracks that were his beginnings and are the backbone of stock car racing.
15 years ago, they were all the good drivers. If somebody was in your way, you put the bumper on them, you moved them out the way. You know, under ordinary circumstances, I try not to be too aggressive. I try to do whatever inside of me tells me to do. You know, it's just something you do. It's from feel. You do it from feel. Whatever it feels like you need to do is what you do.
Tommy Ellis, who currently is second, we are in a red condition here, just about ready to turn the field loose. They're beginning to roll right now. Don't forget our next live event here from World Sports, the All-Pro Auto Parts 300, coming up Saturday, October 7th. Let's go to Dave Despain.
If indeed Tommy Ellis is going to win this Grand National Championship this year, the guy he's going to have to beat is Tommy Houston. And you can tell that James Hoggart is a Tommy Houston fan by the look of his hat up there. Tommy's not having the best day today. You comfortable with where he's running out there?
Well, he's doing all right. He's had a little bit of tire problems. Seventh now. Hopefully he can move up some more and get it back ahead of Tommy.
How do you see this championship shaking down? He had a pretty good lead, and then after Darlington, he only had 15 points coming into this one. You think he's going to win it?
Well, I believe so. Tommy's been running good all season. He's had some problems, been in a few wrecks that weren't really his fault, but other than that, he's been doing real good.
Right, there's a man who thinks that he's going to pull out that championship. We're back underway with the race cars. Let's go back to Ken Squire.
Getting set to run once again as Tommy Houston will lie seventh on this restart.
Ken, Tommy Ellis is a throwback. As he said, he's a real aggressive driver. He has a sort of a strong temper, and he'll stand up to you real quick, not unlike Dale Earnhardt or a Rusty Wallace type situation. He married a beautiful lady a few years ago that mild that temper down real bad, and he's getting right humble now. I mean, I used to look up to him like he was really one of the tough guys. Now he's turned a little wimpy since he married that wife, so that's probably the best thing that ever happened, because she sure took the fire out of that man.
I can't wait to tell him you said he was wimpy. We'll see how much fire he's got.
177 laps are complete. We're running again, and the laps are counting. Anybody got any nominees for that Goody's Headache Award? I think it's a co-award this year between Ford Gant and effort made by Rick Wilson that got stymied up here in the wall.
They were both running excellent. Mark had trouble, you know, with the tires. It's hard to say.
And later we'll be taking a look at that True Value Award for the top mechanic in the race. I think we got to wait for the end of it to see how that's going to be decided as Bobby Hamilton stays first. Here you see Wallace, the 36 car, that is third as they get set to go.
I'm anxious to see on this restart because Mark Martin is so strong and been so good. He's going to try to get his lap back. Will Tommy Ellis follow him right through and jump in there to the lead? Because I think if Tommy Ellis gets in front, he's going to be almost impossible to beat.
I'd like to say hello to Tim Sullivan watching down in Florida today. He's recovering from eye surgery. One of the folks responsible for Motor Racing Network years ago on the mend. Glad to know things are better, Tim. Just about set to go. You're going to like this one with Hamilton up in front, Tommy Ellison second, Kenny Wallace third, Moroso fourth, Jack Ingram fifth, Dale Earnhardt sixth, Tommy Houston seventh, Ronald Cooper eighth. Those are the drivers in the lead lap as we get set to settle it. 179 will be complete when they come down to take green in this 200 lap event on the 3/4 mile Richmond International Raceway. Great scramble all afternoon. Wild action. As always in NASCAR's $3 million series, the Grand National ranks to the strike. Flag is out, and Hamilton busts out. Bobby Hamilton is away. Here comes Ellis with him now. The 8 car, the Buick. First and second position in this event. The Pontiac is in third. Here's Ellis. He's trying to get a jump off that fourth corner on the inside. Not able to do so. Try again here in turn one. Or it shortens up real quick in turn two.
Neil, if you were Tommy Ellis, what would you do now?
I'm trying to pass that number 8 car, but it looks like he's got his hands full with it.
Where would you go for him?
I'd say Tommy's car is awful good right down in the middle of 3 and 4. The 8 car is running a little bit high. Tommy's strong in this area right here. I think if he can do anything with him, it's going to be right there. So with me saying that, he'll probably pass him out too.
Bobby Hamilton come a long way in a hurry. Short time, stays out in front. What an upset this would be. His best finish to date, second at Nashville and a third at Myrtle Beach. Here comes Ellis down on the inside, has the drop, no, half a car length. Back goes number 8 Wallace. He qualified 29th. He's fought his way through the field, currently 15th in points in NASCAR's Grand National ranks. Showed up at the beginning of this year, and they were touting him over in Nashville. Said, this is your next Walter. This is your next Earnhardt. Everybody said, oh, sure. But look at it. Running smoothly. Lots of pressure on it. Getting a wheel out of line right here in one. And Ellis, the wily veteran, stays right on it. Wallace stays third. Moroso is in fourth. Now 183 of the 200 laps complete. We'll be back for the finish at Richmond in a moment. Live, this is for the lead. Bobby Hamilton looking for his first Grand National win. Stays up in front. Tommy Ellis, defending Grand National champion, lies second, looking for his 22nd win. 10 laps to go. This time by as car number 8 comes into the main straightaway. The crew chief on this car, and give him that true value award for putting one together that's come all the way from the 29th position to get up in here. Kip McCord, who was the crew chief a year ago for Mike Alexander. What a job he has done for Hamilton. He's with Mike Joy.
He's no stranger to victory lane, Ken, but Kip, has he got the savvy to pull it off, your young driver?
I don't know. He's gotten real excited here lately. He said he had never been in that position. I think he's doing a good job. I hope he can keep his composure and pull it off. We had a problem about halfway during the race. His mirror fell off, so our spotters kind of had to drive him through traffic. And he's doing a pretty good job, and I don't know, maybe he'll pull it off.
Well, like Satchel Paige never said, if you can't see behind you, you don't know what's gaining on you.
Thanks, Mike. Here's car number 8 leading. Here's Ellis closing again. 192, working 193 right now as number 8 stays in front. And you see that yellow rookie stripe on the rear fender, on the rear bumper of car number 8 as it comes off turn 4. A little smoke there.
He's smoking those tires. He's driving it as hard as it'll go, and he sure is holding. Tommy's tried and fired his best shot. And I think if he can just hold out there, I think he can win this thing.
Looks awful good, I tell you. You don't need a bumper. I mean, you don't need a mirror with Tommy back there. If he gets close, he'll feel him.
car length away, coming by 194 complete this time. Ellis on home turf. Won here twice in the old days in the half mile. Set on the pole today in 99. And the eight car was just another car in the field when it all got started. And look at him now from 29th position. Young Bobby Hamilton of Nashville, Tennessee, just having an outstanding run.
Well, if Tommy Ellis does not win this race, and the 8 car is able to hold on, I've got to compliment on Tommy Ellis from coming all the way from the back of the field, and he did have a chance to lay the fender to him one time earlier and did not, and that's really neat.
Well, we've joked all day off and on about these guys bumping around. That's just a breed, a part of this type of racing, but Tommy Ellis gave the boy plenty of room, and I'm telling you, he's doing an excellent job.
Here's his wife looking on, coming down to the end of this one. That Hamilton just, staying first.
That just gave me cold chills to see her excitement. You know, she can't stand it. I wish she'd just go in the truck. I mean, this is hero stuff. I mean, this is a kid that's a rookie going to win the big time.
This is going to the bank.
Yes, sir. This ever happened to you, Neil?
Well, it's been a long time since I won one. I'm having to think back a little bit, but it sure is a lot of fun when you do.
Well, you may be seeing a little history here today. Bobby Hamilton looking to win his first Grand National race. Stays in front, 197. Now complete. Bobby Scruggs, the NASCAR starter, about to put the two-lap marker on the field.
Boy,
down to it.
He's smoking those tires off four. He's getting everything he's got right now.
32 years old. Grew up in the old Nashville Fairgrounds. Comes here to the Richmond, Virginia Fairgrounds and has this spectacular performance going. Down to the inside comes 99. Here's Ellis. He knows it's showtime. White flag is out. One to go. Ellis closes in turn number one. Tommy Ellis, this is it. Into one. Ellis diving lower. Moves in. Creeping closer out of turn number two. Back straightaway. Rookie Hamilton holding on. Ellis falls back a little going into number three.
White
can't watch. We're into traffic as we come out of number four. Coming down to the line. And a new winner, the 15th different winner of 1989 in NASCAR Grand National Racing, and you're about to meet a new star. Hamilton does it. He beats the Earnharts. He beats the Waltrips, the Tommy Ellises, the Morosos, teams that everyone thought were going to have a great day here today. There's a new name, and it's a big surprise. We'll meet him in a moment.
And what I love, he really doesn't have a sponsor on the side. There he has one on the hood, but I tell you, there's liable to be something written on the side of that car real soon.
Well, that lighting and fans outfit have been with him since the outset of his Grand National run. And what a day for Filbert Martuzzi, the car owner. And they pull into victory lane. There's going to be some excitement there, and the old cars are steaming.
I tell you what, Ken, they might as well go down and take a little bit of that yellow tape off, make that thing a little bit smaller. He doesn't need that much anymore.
Ellis and Houston now not just 9 points apart as they get ready for Dover, Delaware, September the 16th. It's a great race for Hamilton. What a great day for Grand National Racing. A surprise, that's what you like to see, is a new guy break through and beat the venerable champions of this great racing division. Grand National ranks was where you really started.
I'll tell you what, I look down here.